ماريا القبطية رضي الله عنها. Then he says, ووهبت نوبتها لعائشة سودة ما دامت زمانا عائشة. سودة بنت زمعة رضي الله عنها. The second wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The first one after Khadija. When Khadija رضي الله عنها died, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم married سودة بنت زمعة. And she remained alone until the Hijrah, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم started the marriage actually with Aisha, because the nikah was done before and or the qiran, and then started in Hijrah. So around 3 years the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم remained with Sauda alone. And subhanallah, this also shows us the same incident that I discussed before, when Umar ibn Khattab told Al-Abbas that your Islam, your conversion to Islam, is more beloved to me than the conversion of my father if he would have converted. And of course, we all, as I said, we all love our fathers to be in Jannah. But Umar al-Khattab says, no, you Abbas, your Islam is more beloved to me than the Islam of my father. Why? Because it's more beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And here Sauda radiallahu anha, she gave up her day. The Prophet ﷺ used to give his wives one day for each, one night for each. And because Sauda radiallahu anha knew that the most beloved person to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is Aisha bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anhuma. So she gave up her own night to make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam happier. And subhanallah, that's the mentality of the Sahaba. Whatever more beloved to the Prophet ﷺ becomes more beloved to them. If the Prophet ﷺ is happier, they are happier. Anything, it's not their own personal desires, no. It's what makes the Prophet ﷺ happier, and what is more beloved to the Prophet ﷺ becomes genuinely more beloved to them from their hearts, not pretending. رضي الله عنهم وارضاهم. So the Prophet ﷺ, then after she granted Aisha her day, after Sauda رضي الله عنها granted Aisha رضي الله عنها her day, Aisha started getting 2 days while all other wives getting one day. Then he says, وعمل المنبر غير مختفي وحج عتاب بأهل الموقف. Then the minbar of the Prophet ﷺ, the podium, as if we can translate it to this, where the Prophet ﷺ used to go up and do all khutbas. There was no minbar before that. So, and this hadith narrated in Bukhari and Muslim and many other books. The Prophet عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخطب على جذع فلما اتخذ المنبر تحول إليه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to go up on a trunk of a palm tree in some narrations. Then when the minbar was built, when the podium was built, and it was 3 steps as according to some narrations, فحن الجذع, سبحان الله. The old place where the Prophet ﷺ used to rise and give khutbas, حن. حن, as explained with more details in other narrations from other Sahaba, they said, we heard sound like a cry. Some of them said like the she camel that lost her kid. SubhanAllah, this sound came out of the trunk of a tree. فَحَنَّ الْجِذْرُ فَأَتَاهُ فَمَسَحَ يَدَهُ عَلَيْهِ. Then the Prophet ﷺ went and wiped on that trunk. In another narration, another authentic narration, عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه وأنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يخطب إلى جذع. Same thing, the Prophet ﷺ used to give khutbas from جذع, from trunk. فلما اتخذ المنبر ذهب إلى المنبر فحن الجذع فأتاه فاحتضنه فسكن. The minbar started making that sound, the crying sound, the grief sound, and the Prophet ﷺ went and hugged it, and then it became silent. Subhanallah. And in another narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, لو لم أحتضنه لحن إلى يوم القيامة. If I did not hug that trunk, it would have remained crying or making this sound to the day of judgment. And this hadith in Sahih ibn Majah wa Sahihahu al-Albani. And now, why I mentioned a couple of narrations about this, because Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah used to say something about this hadith and this narration. As Ibn Hibban rahimahullah mentioned in his Sahih book, أن الحسن إذا حد كان إذا حدث بهذا الحديث بكى. When الحسن البصري رحمه الله narrates this hadith, he starts crying. And then he says, explaining why he's crying, يا عباد الله الخشبة تحن إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الخشبة, the wood feels something, تحن شوقا إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The wood feels that emotional feeling towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam لِمَكَانِهِ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Not because he's Muhammad ibn Abdullah, no, because he's the messenger of Allah, because he's a prophet of Allah. That's why this wood is having this emotions. And he says, فَأَنْتُمْ أَحَقُّ أَن تَشْتَاقُوا إِلَى لِقَائِهِ. You have more right to have this feeling to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah, look at this understanding. We have to be jealous of this tree, this piece of wood, because we have more right as Muslims. We have to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the most, and we have to have that feeling inside our hearts, genuine feeling that we would love to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Jannah. That's one of our main goals in this life. We love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we want to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Jannah. We want to drink from his hawd. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to drink from his hawd. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among prophets and righteous and shuhada. Allahumma ameen. So that's very important feeling. We should always imagine whenever we do something, whenever we think about something, that if the Prophet ﷺ is with me right now, if he's alive with us, would he be happy for me as a Muslim, as a follower of him, doing this action or saying those words or talking about my brother or anything we do? We have to think, will that make the Prophet ﷺ happier if we're living with him or not? That's the actual love. Because love to the Prophet ﷺ, and by the way, the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ. No one will have a complete iman until حَتَّى أَكُونُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ وَالِدِهِ وَوَلَدِهِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. Until the Prophet ﷺ becomes the most beloved person to us, then we can say, yes, we have complete iman. When we love the Prophet ﷺ more than anyone else, more than fathers, more than kids, more than all mankind, then we have a complete iman. So how do we love the Prophet ﷺ? Obviously not by singing about him, not by saying poems about him day and night. Of course, that's a good thing. It's not bad. I'm not saying it's bad, but this is not the actual love. The actual love is by following him, by copying him, by living as much as we can, because of course we cannot reach his level as the best mankind, alayhi salatu wasalam. But we have to try our best as much as possible to copy his actions, to do all the sunnahs that we can do. Some of the Sahaba, just to understand the level of love, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma used to copy the Prophet ﷺ literally, even with the things that he knows it's not part of the sunnah. One of the examples, One day they were going to Hajj and he went in a certain place to the restroom, to لقضاء الحاجة. And he said, I didn't need to, but I saw the Prophet ﷺ going in this place and I just wanted to copy him to this level. Just copying the Prophet ﷺ as much as possible, even with the things that they know it's not required and it's not actually sunnah, but that's the actual love. That's the genuine love. And we see now when people love famous, when people love influencers, they start copying them. Literally copying them. How they move, how they talk, how they make jokes, how they dance. We see our kids, how they are acting. So we have to start with ourselves and then pass it to our kids. And inshallah our kids pass it to their kids. That the love of the Prophet ﷺ is first. It's more than anyone else on this planet. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the love of Him and His Prophets. Jazakumullah khair.